Chapter 1 of The Castaways of the Flag. The Castaways of the Flag by Jules Verne. Chapter 1. The Castaways. Night. A pitch dark night. It was almost impossible to distinguish sky from sea. From the sky, laden with clouds, low and heavy, deformed and tattered, lightning flashed every now and then, followed by muffled rolls of thunder. At these flashes the horizon lit up for a moment and showed deserted and melancholy. No wave broke in foam upon the surface of the sea. There was nothing but the regular and monotonous rolling of the swell, and the gleam of ripples under the lightning flashes. Not a breath moved across the vast plain of ocean, not even the hot breath of the storm. But electricity so charged the atmosphere that it escaped in phosphorescent light, and ran up and down the rigging of the boat in tongues of St. Elmo's fire. Although the sun had set 4 or 5 hours ago, the sweltering heat of the day had not passed. Two men talked in low tones in the stern of a big ship's boat that was decked in to the foot of the mast. Her foresail and jib were flapping as the monotonous rolling shook her. One of these men, holding the tiller tucked under his arm, tried to dodge the cruel swell that rolled the boat from side to side. He was a sailor, about 40 years of age, thick-set and sturdy, with a frame of iron on which fatigue, privation, even despair had never taken effect. An Englishman by nationality, this boatswain was named John Block. The other man was barely 18, and did not seem to belong to the seafaring class. In the bottom of the boat, under the poop and seats, with no strength left to pull the oars, a number of human beings were lying, among them a child of 5 years old, a poor little creature whose whimpering was audible, whom its mother tried to hush with idle talk and kisses. Before the mast, upon the poop, and near the jib-stays, two people sat motionless and silent, hand in hand, lost in the most gloomy thoughts. So intense was the darkness that it was only by the lightning flashes that they could see each other. From the bottom of the boat a head was lifted sometimes, only to droop again at once. The boatswain spoke to the young man lying by his side. "No, no, I watched the horizon until the sun went down. No land in sight, not a sail. But what I didn't see this evening will perhaps be visible at dawn." "But, bosun," his companion answered, "we must get to land somewhere in the next 48 hours, or we shall have succumbed." "That's true," John Block agreed. "Land must appear, simply must. Why, continents and islands were made on purpose to give shelter to brave men, and one always ends by getting to them. If the wind helps one, bosun." "That is the only reason wind was invented," John Block replied. "Today, as bad luck would have it, it was busy somewhere else, in the middle of the Atlantic or the Pacific, perhaps, for it didn't blow enough here to fill my cap. Yes, a jolly good gale would blow us merrily along."
"Or swallow us up, Block."
"Oh, no, not that. No, no, not that. Of all the ways to bring this job to a finish, that would be the worst."
"Who can tell, bosun?"
Then for some minutes the two men were silent. Nothing could be heard but the gentle rippling under the boat. "How is the captain?" the young man went on.
"Captain Gould, good man, is in bad case," John Block replied. "How those blackguards knocked him about. The wound in his head makes him cry out with pain. And it was an officer in whom he had every confidence who stirred those wretches up. No, no. One fine morning, or one fine afternoon, or perhaps one fine evening, that rascal of a Borup shall make his last ugly face at the yardarm, or—"
"The brute! The brute!" the young man exclaimed, clenching his fists in wrath.
"Aye, aye. And when I put him back under the poop, after I had put compressors on his head, he was able to speak to me, though very feebly.
'Thanks, Block, thanks,' he said. As if I wanted thanks.
'And land? What about land?' he asked.
'You may be quite sure, Captain,' I told him, 'that there is land somewhere, and perhaps not very far off.' He looked at me and closed his eyes."
And the boatswain murmured in an aside, "Land, land. Ah, Borupt and his accomplices knew very well what they were about. While we were shut up in the bottom of the hold, they altered the course. They went some hundreds of miles away before they cast us adrift in this boat. In seas where a ship is hardly ever seen, I guess."
The young man had risen. He stooped, listening to port.
"Didn't you hear anything, Block?" he asked.
"Nothing, nothing at all," the boatswain answered. "This swell is as noiseless as if it were made of oil instead of water." The young man said no more, but sat down again with his arms folded across his breast. Just at this moment one of the passengers sat up and exclaimed, with a gesture of despair, "I wish a wave would smash this boat up and swallow us all up with it. Rather than that we should all be given over to the horrors of starvation. Tomorrow we shall have exhausted the last of our provisions.
we shall have nothing left at all.
Tomorrow is tomorrow, Mr. Wolston, the boatswain replied. If the boat were to capsize, there wouldn't be any tomorrow for us. And while there is a tomorrow...
John Block is right, his young companion answered. We must not give up hope, James. Whatever danger threatens us, we are in God's hands, to dispose of as he thinks fit. His hand is in all that comes to us, and it is not right to say that he has withdrawn it from us.
I know, James whispered, drooping his head, but one is not always master of oneself.
Another passenger, a man of about 30, one of those who had been sitting in the bows, approached John Block and said,
Bosun, since our unfortunate captain was thrown into this boat with us, and that is a week ago already, it is you who have taken his place. So our lives are in your hands. Have you any hope?
Have I any hope? John Block replied. Yes, I assure you I have. I hope these infernal calms will come to an end shortly and that the wind will take us safe to harbour.
Safe to harbour? The passenger answered, his eyes trying to pierce the darkness of the night. Well, what the deuce? John Block exclaimed. There is a harbour somewhere. All we have to do is to steer for it, with the wind whistling through the yards. Good Lord, if I were the Creator, I would show you half a dozen islands lying all round us, waiting our convenience.
We won't ask for as many as that, bosun, the passenger replied, unable to refrain from smiling.
Well, John Block answered, if he will drive our boat towards one of those which exist already, it will be enough, and he need not make any islands on purpose, although I must say he seems to have been a bit stingy with them hereabouts.
But where are we?
I can't tell you, not even within a few hundred miles, John Block replied.
You know that for a whole long week we were shut up in the hold, unable to see what course the ship was shaping, whether south or north.
Anyhow, it must have been blowing steadily, and the sea did plenty of rolling and chopping.
That is true, John Block, and true, too, that we must have gone a long way, but in what direction?
About that I don't know anything, the boatswain declared. Did the ship go off to the Pacific instead of making for the Indian Ocean? On the day of the mutiny we were off Madagascar. But since then, as the wind has blown from the west all the time, we may have been taken hundreds of miles from there, towards the islands of St. Paul and Amsterdam.
Where there are none but savages of the worst possible sort, James Wolston remarked. But, after all, the men who cast us away are not much better.
One thing is certain, John Block declared. That wretch Borrupt must have altered the flag's course and made for water where he will be most likely to escape punishment, and where he and his gang will play pirates. So I think that we were a long way out of our proper course when this boat was cut adrift. But I wish we might strike some island in these seas. Even a desert island would do. We could live all right by hunting and fishing. We should find shelter in some cave. Why shouldn't we make of our island what the survivors of the landlord made of New Switzerland, with strong arms, brains, and pluck?
Very true, James Wolston answered. But the landlord did not fail her passengers. They were able to save her cargo, while we shall never have anything from the flag's cargo.
The conversation was interrupted. A voice that rang with pain was heard.
Drink! Give me something to drink!
It's Captain Gould, one of the passengers said. He is eaten up with fever. Luckily there is plenty of water, and...
That's my job, said the boatswain. Do one of you take the tiller. I know where the can is, and a few mouthfuls will give the captain ease.
And John Block left his seat aft and went forward into the bows of the boat. The three other passengers remained in silence, awaiting his return. After being away for 2 or 3 minutes, John Block came back to his post.
Well? Someone inquired.
Someone got there before me, John Block answered. One of our good angels was with the patient already, pouring a little fresh water between his lips and bathing his forehead that was wet with sweat. I don't know whether Captain Gould was conscious. He seemed to be delirious. He was talking about land. The land ought to be over there, he kept saying, and his hand was wobbling about like the pennon on the mainmast when all winds are blowing at once. I answered, Aye, aye, Captain, quite so. The land is somewhere. We shall reach it soon. I can smell it to northwards. And that is a sure thing. We old sailors can smell land like that. And I said, too, Don't be uneasy, Captain. Everything is all right. We have a stout boat, and I will keep her course steady. There must be more islands hereabouts than we could know what to do with. Too many to choose from. We shall find one to suit our convenience, an inhabited island where we shall find a welcome and where we shall be sent home from. The poor chap understood what I said, I am sure, and when I held the lantern near his face he smiled to me, such a sad smile, and at the good angel too. Then he closed his eyes again and fell asleep almost at once. Well, I may have lied pretty heavily when I talked about land to him as if it were only a few miles off, but was I far wrong?
No, Block, the youngest passenger replied, That is the kind of lie that God allows. The conversation ended, and the silence was only broken thereafter by the flapping of the sail against the mast as the boat rolled from one side to the other. Most of those who were aboard her, broken down by fatigue and weakened by long privation, forgot their terrors in heavy sleep. Although these unhappy people still had something wherewith to quench their thirst, they would have nothing wherewith to appease their hunger in the coming days. Of the few pounds of salt meat that had been flung into the boat when she was pushed off, nothing now remained. They were reduced to one bag of sea biscuits for 11 people. How could they manage if the calm persisted? And for the last 48 hours not one breath of breeze had stolen through the stifling atmosphere, not even one of those intermittent gusts which are like the last sighs of a dying man. It meant death by starvation, and that within a short time. There was no steam navigation in those days, so the probability was that, in the absence of wind, no ship would come in sight, and, in the absence of wind, the boat could not reach land, whether island or continent. It was necessary to have perfect faith in God to combat utter despair, or else to possess the unshakable philosophy of the boatswain, which consisted in refusing to see any but the bright side of things. Even now he muttered to himself, Aye, I know. The time will come when the last biscuit will have been eaten. But as long as one can keep one's stomach, one mustn't grumble, even if there is nothing to put in it. Now, if one hadn't got a stomach left, even if there were plenty to put in it, that would be really serious. 2 hours passed. The boat had not moved a cable's length, for there was only the motion of the swell to affect her. Now the swell does not move forward. It merely makes the surface of the water undulate. A few chips of wood that had been thrown over the side the day before were still floating close by, and the sail had not filled once to move the boat away from them. While merely afloat like this, it was little use to remain at the helm. But the boatswain declined to leave his post. With the tiller under his arm, he tried at least to avoid the lurching which tilted the boat to one side and another, and thus to spare his companions excessive shaking. It was about 3 o'clock in the morning when John Block felt a light breath pass across his cheeks, roughened and hardened as they were by the salt sea air.
"Can the wind be getting up?" he murmured as he rose.
He turned towards the south, and, wetting his finger in his mouth, held it up. There was a distinct sensation of coldness, caused by the evaporation, and now a distant rippling sound became audible. He turned to the passenger sitting on the middle bench, near one of the women. "Mr. Fritz," he said. Fritz Robinson raised his head and bent round. "What do you want, bosun?" he asked. "Look over there, towards the east. What do you think you see? If I'm not mistaken, a kind of rift, like a belt, on the waterline." Unmistakably, there was a lighter line along the horizon in that direction. Sky and sea could be distinguished with more definiteness. It was as if a rent had just been made in the dome of mist and vapour.
"It's wind," the boatswain declared.
"Isn't it only the first beginning of daybreak?" the passenger asked.
"It might be daylight, though it's very early for it," John Block replied. "And again, it might be a breeze. I felt something of it in my beard just now. And look, it's twitching still. I'm aware it's not a breeze to fill the topgallant sails, but anyhow it's more than we've had for the last 24 hours. Put your hand to your ear, Mr. Fritz, and listen. You'll hear what I heard."
"You are right," said the passenger, leaning over the gunwale. "It is the breeze."
"And we're ready for it," the boatswain replied. "With the foresail block and tackle, we've only got to haul the sheet taut to save all the wind which is rising."
"But where will it take us?"
"Wherever it likes," the boatswain answered. "All I want it to do is to blow us out of these cursed waters."
20 minutes went by. The breath of wind, which at first was almost imperceptible, grew stronger. The rippling aft became louder. The boat made a few rougher motions, not caused by the slow, nauseating swell. Folds of the sail spread out, fell flat, and opened again, and the sheet sagged against its cleats. The wind was not strong enough yet to fill the canvas of the foresail and the jib. Patience was needed, while the boat's head was kept to her course as well as might be by means of one of the sculls. A quarter of an hour later, progress was marked by a light wake. Just at this moment, one of the passengers who had been lying in the bows got up and looked at the rift in the clouds to the eastward.
"Is it a breeze?" he asked.
"Yes," John Block answered. "I think we have got it this time, like a bird in the hand, and we won't let go of it." The wind was beginning to spread steadily now through the rift, through which, too, the first gleams of light must come. From southeast to southwest, the clouds still hung in heavy masses, over 3/4 of the circumference of the sky.
It was still impossible to see more than a few cable's lengths from the boat, and beyond that distance no ship could have been detected. As the breeze had freshened, the sheet had to be hauled in, the foresail, whose gear was slackened, hoisted, and the course veered a point or two, so as to give the jib a hold on the wind. "We've got it! We've got it!" the boatswain said cheerily, and the boat, heeling gently over to starboard, dipped her nose into the first waves. Little by little the rent in the clouds grew bigger and spread overhead. The sky assumed a reddish hue. It seemed that the wind might hold to the present quarter for some little time, and that the period of calms had come to an end. Hope of reaching land revived once more, or the alternative hope of falling in with a ship. At 5 o'clock the rent in the clouds was ringed with a collar of vivid coloured clouds. It was the day, appearing with the suddenness peculiar to the low latitudes of the tropical regions. Soon purple rays of light arose above the horizon, like the sticks of a fan. The rim of the solar disk, heightened by the refraction, touched the horizon line, drawn clearly now at the end of sky and sea. At once the rays of light caught on the little clouds which hung in the high heaven, and dyed them every shade of crimson. But they were stubbornly arrested by the dense vapours accumulated in the north, and could not break through them. And so the range of vision, long behind, was still extremely limited in front. The boat was leaving a long wake behind her now, marked in creamy white upon the greenish water. And now the whole sun emerged above the horizon, enormously magnified at its diameter. No haze dimmed its brilliance, which was insupportable to the eye. All aboard the boat looked away from it. They only scanned the north, whither the wind was carrying them. The main question was what the fog screened from them in that direction. At length, just before 6:30, one of the passengers seized the halyards of the foresail and clambered nimbly up to the yardarm, just as the sun cleared the sky to the eastward with its early rays. And in a ringing voice he shouted, "Land!" End of chapter 1.
Chapter 2 of The Castaways of the Flag, Gergen, Gilbert, Arizona. The Castaways of the Flag by Jules Verne. Chapter 2. In England. It was on the 20th of October that the Unicorn had left New Switzerland on her way back to England. On her return, when the Admiralty sent to take possession of the new colony in the Indian Ocean, after a brief stop at the Cape of Good Hope, she was to bring back Fritz and Frank Zermatt, Jenny Montrose, and Dolly Walston. The two brothers took the berths left vacant by the Walstons, who were now settled on the island. A comfortable cabin had been placed at the disposal of Jenny and her little companion Dolly, who was going to join James Walston and his wife and child at Cape Town. After rounding the False Hope Point, the Unicorn sailed westward before the wind and came down to the south again, leaving the island of Burning Rock to her starboard. Before finally leaving New Switzerland, Lieutenant Littlestone decided to reconnoiter its eastern coast as well, in order to satisfy himself that it really was an isolated island in these seas, and to form an approximate idea of the size of a colony which would soon be included among the island dominions of Great Britain. As soon as he had done this, the corvette, with a fair wind behind her, left the island to the northwest, after getting little more than a glimpse of its southern portion through the haze and fog. Fortune favored the first few weeks of the voyage. The passengers on the Unicorn were delighted with the weather, as well as with the cordial treatment which they received from the commander and the other officers. When they all met at table in the officers' mess, or under the awning on the poop, the conversation generally turned upon the wonders of New Switzerland. If the corvette met with nothing to delay her, they all hoped to see it again within the year. Fritz and Jenny often talked of Colonel Montrose, and of the gladness that would be his when he clasped in his arms the daughter whom he had thought he would never see again. For 3 years no news had been received of the Dorcas, whose loss with nearly all hands had been confirmed by the survivors who had been taken to Sydney. But when they reached England, Jenny would present to her father the man who had rescued her, and would beg him to bless their union. As for Frank, though Dolly Walston was only 14, it would not be without a bitter pang that he would leave her at Cape Town, and keen would be his longing to come back to her side. After crossing the tropic, off the Isle of France, the Unicorn encountered less favorable winds. These delayed her arrival at her port until the 17th of December, 2 months after her departure from New Switzerland. The corvette came to anchor in the harbor of Cape Town, where she was to remain for a week. One of the first visitors to come aboard was James Walston. He knew that his father, mother, and two sisters had taken passages on the Unicorn, and his disappointment can be imagined at finding that there was only one sister for him to meet. Dolly presented Fritz and Frank Zermatt to him. "Your father and mother and sister Hannah are living in New Switzerland now, Mr. Walston," Fritz told him, "an unknown island on which my family was cast 12 years ago, after the wreck of the landlord. They have decided to remain there and expect you to join them. When she comes back from Europe, the Unicorn will take you and your wife and child to our island, if you are willing to go with us." "When is the corvette due back at the Cape?" James Walston inquired. "In 8 or 9 months," Fritz replied, "and she will go from here to New Switzerland, where the British flag will be flying. My brother Frank and I have availed ourselves of this opportunity to take back to London the daughter of Colonel Montrose, who, we hope, will consent to come and settle with her in our second fatherland." "And with you too, Fritz dear, for you will have become his son," Jenny added, giving him her hand. "That is my most ardent wish, Jenny dear," said Fritz. "And we and our parents do very much want you to bring your family and settle in New Switzerland," Dolly Walston added. "You must insist on the fact, Dolly," Frank declared, "that our island is the most wonderful island that has ever appeared above the sea." "James will be the first to agree when he has seen it," Dolly answered. "When once you have set foot in New Switzerland and stayed at Rock Castle and roosted at Falconhurst, eh, Dolly?" said Jenny, laughing. "Yes, roosted," the little girl replied. "Well, then you will never want to leave New Switzerland again." "You hear, Mr. Walston?" said Fritz. "I hear, Monsieur Zermatt," James Walston answered. "To settle in your island and open up its first commercial relations with Great Britain is a proposition that I find peculiarly inviting. My wife and I will talk about it, and if we decide to go, we will wind up our affairs and hold ourselves in readiness to embark upon the Unicorn when she comes back to Cape Town. I am sure Susan will not hesitate." "I will do whatever my husband wishes," Mrs. Walston said. Fritz and Frank shook James Walston's hand warmly as Dolly kissed her sister-in-law. "While the corvette stays here," James Walston then explained, "we expect you all to accept the hospitality of our house. That will be the best way to knit our friendship, and we will talk as much as you please about New Switzerland." Naturally, the passengers on the Unicorn accepted this invitation in the spirit in which it had been offered. An hour later, Mr. and Mrs. James Walston received their guests. Fritz and Frank were given a room between them, and Jenny shared the one allotted to Dolly, as she had shared her cabin during the voyage. Mrs. James Walston was a young woman of 24, gentle, intelligent, and devoted to her husband. He was an earnest and active man, very much like his father. They had one boy, Bob, now 5 years old, whom they adored. During the 10 days that the Unicorn remained in the port, from the 17th to the 27th of December, little was talked about but New Switzerland, the events of which it had been the stage, the various works undertaken, and the many contrivances and improvements effected on the island. The subject was never exhausted. Dolly would expatiate on all these wonderful things, and Frank would encourage her to go on, and even find fault with her for not saying enough. Then Jenny Montrose would embroider the tale to Fritz's keen delight. In a word, the time sped, and James Walston and his wife quite made up their minds to leave the Cape for New Switzerland. During the voyage of the corvette home and out again, Walston would employ himself winding up his affairs and realizing his capital. He would be ready to start directly the Unicorn reappeared, and he would be one of the first emigrants to the island. The last goodbyes had to be said at length, with the comforting reflection that in another 8 or 9 months they would be at Cape Town again, and that then they would all put to sea together, outward bound for New Switzerland. Nevertheless, the parting was a painful one. Jenny Montrose and Susan Walston mingled their kisses and tears, to which Dolly's were added. The child was much distressed by Frank's departure, and his heart, too, was heavy, for he had grown very fond of her. As he and his brother clasped James Walston's hand, they could assure themselves that they were leaving there a true friend indeed. The Unicorn put to sea on the 27th, in somewhat overcast weather. Her passage was of average length. For several weeks, winds varied from northwest to southwest. The corvette spoke St. Helena, Ascension, and the Cape Verde Islands. Then, after passing in sight of the Canaries and Azores, off the coasts of Portugal and France, she came up the channel, rounded the Isle of Wight, and, on the 14th of February, dropped anchor at Portsmouth. Jenny Montrose wanted to start at once for London, where her aunt lived. If the colonel were on active service, she would not find him there, since the campaign for which he had been recalled from India might have lasted for several years. But if he had retired, he would have settled near his sister-in-law, and it would be there that he would at length set eyes again upon her, whom he believed to have perished in the wreck of the Dorcas. Fritz and Frank offered to escort Jenny to London, whither business called them also, and Fritz naturally wanted to meet Colonel Montrose soon. So all three set out the same evening, and arrived in London during the morning of the 23rd. But bitter grief fell upon Jenny Montrose. She learned from her aunt that the colonel had died during his last campaign, without the happiness of knowing that the daughter whom he had mourned for was still alive. After coming back from the far waters of the Indian Ocean to embrace her father, hoping never to part from him again, to present her savior to him, and to beg for his consent to their union and his blessing on it, Jenny would never see him more. Her distress was great. In vain her aunt lavished on her words of consolation. In vain Fritz sorrowed with her. The blow was too cruel. She had never even thought of the possibility that her father might be dead. A few days later, in a conversation broken by tears and regrets, Jenny said to him, "Fritz, dear Fritz, we have just experienced the bitterest of misfortunes, you and I. If you have not changed your mind at all—" "Oh, Jenny, my darling," Fritz exclaimed. "Yes, I know," said Jenny, "and my father would have been happy to call you his son. I am sure he would have wanted to go with us and share our life in the new English colony. But I must give up that happiness. I am alone in the world now, and have only myself to depend upon." "Alone?" "No, no, you are there, Fritz." "Jenny," said the young man, "the whole of my life shall be devoted to your happiness." "And mine to yours, Fritz dear. But since my father is no longer here to give us his consent, since I have no near relations living, and since yours is the only family I can call my own, you have belonged to it 3 years already, Jenny dear, ever since the day when I found you on Burning Rock. I love them all, and they love me, Fritz. Well, in a few months more, we shall be with them all again. We shall be back. Married, Jenny?" "Yes, Fritz, if you wish it, since you have your father's consent, and my aunt will not refuse me hers." "Jenny, dear Jenny," Fritz exclaimed, falling on his knees beside her, "our plans will not be changed at all, and I shall take back my wife to my father and mother." Jenny Montrose remained henceforth in her aunt's house, where Fritz and Frank came every day to see her. Meanwhile, all the necessary arrangements were made for the celebration of the marriage within the briefest time that the law permitted. But there was other business of some importance to be attended to, business which had been the purpose of the two brothers in coming to Europe. There was the sale of the various articles of value collected on the island, the coral gathered on Whale Island, the pearls taken from the bay, the nutmegs and the vanilla. Monsieur Zermatt had not been mistaken about their market value. They produced a considerable sum of 8,000 pounds sterling. When one remembered that the banks of Pearl Bay had been no more than skimmed, that coral was to be found on many parts of the coast, that nutmegs and vanilla could be produced in large quantities, and that there were many other treasures in New Switzerland, one had to acknowledge that the colony was destined for a height of prosperity which set it in the foremost of the oversea dominions of Great Britain. In accordance with Monsieur Zermatt's instructions, part of the sum realized from the sale of these articles was to be spent upon things required to complete the stock at Rock Castle and the farms in the Promised Land. The rest, about three-quarters of the whole sum, and the 10,000 pounds coming from Colonel Montrose's estate, were deposited in the Bank of England, upon which Monsieur Zermatt would be able to draw in the future as he might require, thanks to the communication which would soon be established with the capital. Restitution was made of the various jewels and monies belonging to the families of those who had been lost with the landlord, who had been traced after inquiry. Finally, a month after the arrival of Fritz Zermatt and Jenny Montrose in London, their marriage was celebrated there by the chaplain of the corvette. The Unicorn had brought them as an engaged couple, and would take them back to New Switzerland a married couple. All these events excited a considerable interest throughout Great Britain in the family which had been abandoned for a dozen years on an unknown island in the Indian Ocean, and in Jenny's adventures and her stay on Burning Rock. The story, which had been written by Jean Zermatt, appeared in the English and foreign newspapers, and under the title of The Swiss Family Robinson, it was destined to a fame equal to that won already by the immortal work of Daniel Defoe. The consequence of all this was that the Admiralty decided to take possession of New Switzerland. Moreover, this new possession had some very considerable advantages to offer. The island occupied an important position in the east of the Indian Ocean, near the entrance to the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.